Take your Bibles and open them to Hebrews chapter 11, appropriately, where we've been studying the last few days in this excellent conference of rich teaching and fellowship. And this morning, we are basically going to step on the gas pedal as far as zooming through the rest of this chapter to get to the end of this chapter. And we're going to see that the writer of Hebrews does what many preachers do after they've elaborated for some time towards the beginning of their message or this chapter, let's say. They get to the end and they realize I have a lot to cover and I'm just going to zip through it. But we have a lot of rich content here, and it is a privilege to be able to teach the Word of God to you this morning. We're going to cover Hebrews 11, verses 32 through 40. Which is where you should be turned, as we see in this section, the triumphs, trials, and telos of faith. And if you don't know what that word means, we'll get to it. But I want to start with the raging bull. You might say, what in the world does that have to do with Hebrews 11? How many of you have ever been on the raging bull in Chicago at Six Flags? A few from Milwaukee, obviously, over here. It's quite a ride, let me tell you. I had the privilege of going on this once with my family when my son John was just old enough to go on the ride. We went together, and it always helps to go along with someone else. It seems to make it easier. But this ride, as you can see from the aerial view, is quite a ride of highs and lows and exhilarating twists and turns, and thankfully, it has a nice, smooth ending to it. And I was very grateful after riding on it. In fact, I decided after my ride on the Batman and the Superman and then the Raging Bull to top it all off that I have officially retired from roller coaster riding. Sometimes life is like this, isn't it? This is the precipitous drop that starts off the Raging Bull. And life can be like that, can it? With its twists and turns and falls and heights of victory and lows of testing and trials and valleys that are difficult, and then they come to a smooth ending in eternity. And the Christian life is anything but boring. Sometimes people think, well, the Christian life just seems boring. If they're unsaved, they don't know what it's all about. They think it's just a matter of giving up a bunch of things and sitting around and doing nothing, being dull. But we know that is absolutely not true. I like how Leah Haling, in her book, Lifequakes, which Grace Gospel Press publishes, she defines faith as, with this acronym, fantastic adventures in trusting Him. And if you walk by faith, you realize the Christian life is not dull. In fact, we're going to see here in Hebrews 11 the triumphs, the tribulations, and the telos of faith. So let's begin reading, just to get an overview of this section, in verse 32, and we'll read through the end of the chapter, verse 40. You can follow along as I read. Verse 32, it says, "And what more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, also of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, became valiant in battle, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead raised to life again. Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. Still others had trial of mockings and scourgings, yes, and of chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, were tempted, were slain with a sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains, in dens and caves of the earth, and all these, having obtained a good testimony through faith, did not receive the promise. God having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. Now, if you observe this passage carefully, you would note that there are three sections to it, basically. Verses 32 through 35, the first half of verse 35, speak of the triumphs of faith. The second half of verse 35 through verse 38 speak of the tribulations of faith. And verses 39 through 40 speak of the end, or the result or completion of faith, the telos of faith. And so what is this passage all about? This passage teaches us that a walk of faith may have visible, tangible victories in this lifetime, but it may also involve tragic and difficult trials and losses in this lifetime that will bring us great reward and will be worth it all as we proceed by faith and endure to the end by faith in this race of the Christian life. Because the end is worth it all, dear saints. And that's what the readers of the book of Hebrews needed to be reminded of. They needed to be reminded that Jesus Christ is better. This was something they were forgetting. In fact, this is something that we need to be reminded of as believers in this day and age, almost 2,000 years later. Jesus Christ is better. And we won't take the time to develop the first 10 chapters of the book of Hebrews, but we've seen already in this conference that chapters 1 through 10 set forth the person and finished work of Jesus Christ in comparison to Judaism and the Old Testament system of law, which had its purpose up until Christ. But now that Christ, the fulfillment of the law, came, why go back to a system in a dispensation that is no longer effective in the plan and will of God? That would be vanity, foolishness, and worthlessness. And so the writer of Hebrews exhorts and encourages his readers to press on as Jewish believers in Jesus Christ to grow in their Christian faith, not give up or throw in the towel because times were getting tough. And so throughout chapters 1 through 10, we see the writer setting forth the various ways in which Jesus Christ is better. Now, I'd like you to look across the chapter. Just turn one chapter to your left to chapter 10. We see from chapter 10 in particular that these Jewish Christians were tempted to go back to Judaism, and in particular, back to its ritualistic sacrificial system headquartered in Jerusalem at the temple where the sacrifices were to be made. And so he explains these sacrifices. In chapter 10, look at verses 3 and 4. It says, "But in those sacrifices there is a reminder of sins every year, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats could take away sins." So if these Jewish Christians went back to the system of ritual and sacrifice, which was defunct, it would all just be a vain exercise, religiously speaking, because those bulls and goats could never take away their sin. Oh, they could picture the coming sacrifice himself, Jesus Christ, who would take away sin, but that's all they could do. But why go back to pictures when the reality has come? And so he goes on in chapter 10, look at verse 10, verses 10 through 14 in particular. And he says, "By that will, the will of Jesus Christ, in desiring to come to earth and be our Savior, to lay down his life for us, by that will we have been sanctified," or set apart, the word means, "through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins." What a description of what was going on in their day prior to the destruction of the temple in 70 AD. We know that this epistle had to have been written sometime prior, probably in the 60s. And the priests were still functioning in the temple. But in contrast to those priests with their perpetual sacrifices which were ineffective and could never take away sin, verse 12 goes on to say, "But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. From that time, waiting till his enemies are made his footstool, for by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. In other words, those who are coming to Jesus Christ by faith, and at the moment of faith are being positionally and forever set apart unto God, being placed into the very Son of God, positionally himself, by the Spirit of God, through faith and by the grace and finished work of Jesus Christ. But did you notice in verses 10 through 14 the emphasis upon the finality of the work of Jesus Christ? How it was only needed once, in contrast to the bulls and goats? And why was it only needed once? Because its effects were forever. It got the job done. In other words, his work on the cross was finished. And for many years as a Roman Catholic, I did not understand why Jesus Christ had to die on the cross. Though I had a crucifix in my bedroom, though I wore a crucifix around my neck, though I'd go to church every week and see the crucifix there on the altar as the centerpiece of the entire church building, I had no idea what he accomplished there, though I knew it had something to do with sin. So I trusted in my works instead of his work, because I didn't understand he had paid for all sin for all time, and I could not add to what he had done. And that's what religion does. It says, oh, Jesus Christ is nice. Yes, we need Jesus, but you know what? We need more than Jesus. He did his part, now you got to do your part. In fact, while I was Roman Catholic and I was being witnessed to by Protestants and evangelicals and people who were concerned for my salvation, I remember trying to refine my response to them and saying, well, yeah, Jesus is necessary. He opened the door to heaven. Can't we agree on that? Oh, doesn't that sound nice? Yes, he opened the door to heaven, but I remember telling someone this, there's a ladder from earth to heaven, and that's where the Ten Commandments come in, and we got to climb that ladder. Sounds more like 90% Tom Stegall and 10% Jesus, if that. But that's religion, always seeking to add to Jesus Christ's work because they don't believe it's finished. He didn't pay it all. And the fact to prove that he paid it all was that he sat down, this passage says. And those Old Testament priests operating under the law never sat down in the temple or tabernacle because their work was never done. Christ's work was different. And because he paid for our sin in full, leaving nothing left to pay, therefore, there's nothing that we have to give to God to get into heaven. In fact, he wants to give us something. The direction of salvation is always from God to man. God is not asking us to offer him anything to get into heaven. He is asking us to receive the offering he made and to receive it simply by faith as a gift, a free gift. Now, we're coming up to that time of year in which the holidays are approaching, and maybe you're already starting to think of the gifts you're going to buy. You can get some good deals this time of year before the last rush. But what do you do with gifts that you buy, you give them to someone else? Now, have you ever had somebody offer you money for the gift that you hand them? That's just considered rude in our society. And it's not grace to try and pay for a gift that somebody else purchased. But so often, that's what people do religiously. They seek to pay God back for what he is trying to give us by his grace, his unmerited, undeserved favor. This gift has been paid for in full by Jesus Christ. The only way it can be received now, and it must be received, you must personally receive this if you never have, is by faith in Jesus Christ. You believe what he did for you. You place your trust in his work rather than your own works, and you are eternally saved. Now, the Christian life is lived exactly the same way that we were born again or justified in God's sight, saved from the penalty of sin by faith. Now we are to, instead of taking one step of faith, putting our trust in Christ, we're to put consecutive steps together in a walk of faith. While we look back to the work of Jesus Christ on the cross, we reckon upon the fact as believers now that we've died with him, we've been buried with him, risen with him, we're seated with him in the heavenlies. Our identity is wrapped up in Jesus Christ. And we also look forward by faith. That's hope. We look forward by the promises of God to our Savior coming back again for us, our blessed hope. And in the meantime, based on the wealth we have by God's grace, the riches of Jesus Christ, we walk by faith and we war by faith. That's what the book of Ephesians is all about. So the Christian life is lived through the very same instrumental means, faith. This time, though, in the Christian life, it's a walk of faith. And Hebrews 11:6 states that without faith, it's impossible to please God, for he who comes to God must believe that he is the reward, that he exists, and he's the rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So why is faith so important? Because of the nature of God, who he is. He exists, and he's a giver, and in fact, he wants to give graciously. Do we believe that so as to receive that? Furthermore, because of the approval of God, it is impossible to please God without faith. It doesn't matter how many works you do. You could outgive a Mormon, a Hindu, someone who gives their life, sets themselves on fire, a Buddhist monk. It doesn't matter. Without faith, you cannot please God. He is impressed with what his son has done, and it all starts there. Do you believe that? So not only is faith important, but what is faith? We've talked about faith a lot at this conference. Let's talk about what it is. The Greek word in the New Testament, the noun form is pistis, its verb form pistuo, and it literally means to rely on, trust in, or depend upon. And it involves the elements of knowledge. You have to know something in order to believe it. You've got to know about a person before you trust in him. It involves mental assent in the sense that you agree with the message, the gospel message. So when you hear the gospel message and you believe it, you in essence say to God, you don't even have to say it verbally, you don't even have to say it in your mind, but in essence you're saying to God, amen, I agree. And that agreement is assent. And it, at that very moment that you believe and agree with the gospel, you have placed your trust in Jesus Christ. It's not like there's a third step here you have to take. When you believe the gospel, you've trusted in the person of Jesus Christ, and vice versa. So personal trust is involved. Knowledge of the gospel is involved. And mental assent to it, your volition, is involved there. Faith also needs a subject to do the believing, that would be us, and it needs an object, namely Jesus Christ. And also the value of your faith lies only in its object. Again, you could have oodles and oodles of faith, but if it's in the wrong object, that faith means absolutely nothing. The only object that really gives value to faith is Jesus Christ and the gospel message. So those are some basic facts about faith, but now God wants to take knowledge of his word, knowledge of his character, person, promises, and have us live by faith, daily relying upon him in a walk of faith so as to please him. For remember what Hebrews 11:6 says? To believers now, without faith it's impossible to do what? Please him. Do you want to please him? I do. I think, most of the time. Sometimes I don't. But we should. He wants to be pleased. These Hebrew readers of this epistle, had forgotten this truth. They were believers in Jesus Christ already. This book is not written to those who may or may not be saved to prove that they're saved if they persevere to the end. It is written to those who are already holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, chapter 3, verse 1 says. But they had become dull of hearing. They were spiritually immature. The writer says, by this time you ought to be teachers. Now, would you ever say that to somebody who had never been born again? Well, by this time, by what time? Time hasn't even started for someone who hasn't been born again. But they had grown dull of hearing, And thus, the writer of Hebrews says, I don't even know how much more I can really teach you because you're dull of hearing. They weren't growing as they should. So they were immature babes in Jesus Christ, but religious babes. And they needed to persevere in the faith. There are various admonitions throughout this epistle exhorting them to hold fast your confession. Endure, persevere, looking unto Jesus. We also know that they suffered persecution. They had their goods plundered. They had been beaten and punished. Not to the point of physical death, however. They hadn't shed blood yet against striving against sin. That could come. But so they are encouraged then to keep looking unto Jesus Christ in the race. So that's the context for this epistle. That Christ is better, so press on in faith in him. Now the writer of Hebrews in chapter 11, if we go back there, in verses 32 through 35, begins to set forth several positive examples of faith. He's already done so with at least 13 individuals mentioned throughout the chapter. And now he's going to speed it up and bring us from the time period of Abel in Genesis 4 all the way through we've already seen him go from Abel in Genesis 4 to Rahab in the book of Joshua. Now in these verses, he's going to go from the time period of the judges through the kings and the prophets, and I think even up to the time of Jesus Christ. And so picking it up in verse 32 again, it says, And what more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, also of David and Samuel and the prophets. Now he's lumping them all into one basket. And I'll tell you this, the time would fail us if I gave the same amount of time to each of these characters we just read about as we have had in previous studies. So what we're going to do is a little jet ski this morning. We're going to kind of bounce across the top of the waves here and just hit the highlights. We could take a whole series and go into each of these characters, but we're not going to do that. So what we see in verses 32 through 35, first of all, is positive examples of faith. Those who had triumphs in this lifetime of faith, at least triumphs that we would outwardly, with the visible eye, consider to be triumphs. Things that were more obvious spiritual triumphs by faith. In verse 33, it says that these individuals mentioned in verse 32, through faith, what did they do? Notice there's always an outcome in terms of a good work or good deeds wrought by a walk of faith throughout Hebrews. So this is the Christian life we're talking about here, or at least a walk of faith for one who's saved. Verse 33, what was the result of faith? They subdued kingdoms, it says. They subdued kingdoms. Now we know that Barak, God used him to help subdue the Canaanites who were in the land of Israel, God's promised land. Gideon was used to subdue the Midianites. Jephthah was used to subdue the Ammonites. Samson was used to subdue the Philistines. And by the time you come to David, it says in 2 Samuel chapter 8 that the nations around Israel had been subdued as well through his walk of faith, as God used him as an instrument. Notice what 2 Samuel 8:14 says. He also put garrisons in Edom, that's a country to the east of Israel. Throughout all Edom, he put garrisons, and all the Edomites became David's servants. They were subjected to David as a king in his rule. And the Lord preserved David wherever he went. That was the key right there, the last part of verse 14, that God was with David. And David was just simply an instrument that God used as he relied upon the Lord and let the power of God and the plan of God be worked out through his life. And that's exactly what he wants in each of our lives as well. Are you seeking to be an instrument, a vessel for him to use? You know, when it comes to the church age, we're not subduing kingdoms, are we? At least, I hope we're not. That is not what he's called us to do. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 12 tell us that our warfare is not physical. It's not in this physical realm against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and spiritual forces in high places, the demonic realm, because there's a greater spiritual battle going on for the souls of men. That's why our warfare involves the gospel message going forth. Not to build the kingdom on the earth. We've never been called to do that. The kingdom is yet future, and it is coming, but Christ will be the one to usher it in. In the meantime, we walk in warfare by faith, and we are called to share the gospel and to see people through the gospel message get saved off of the sinking ship. The church is the called out assembly, called out from the world, not called alongside of it, not called to get in the boat with it, called out of it by the gospel. And Christ is building his church in this dispensation. We see in this passage going on as well that they work righteousness, verse 33 says. The very next verse that we just read, 2 Samuel 8:15, goes on to say, so David reigned over all Israel. And it summarizes saying, David administered justice and righteousness for all his people. What is the result of your walk of faith? It is God producing his righteousness in and through you. So the righteous deeds that come out of your life are not produced by you. They're the outflow of what the Spirit of God in you is doing as you rely on him. Works do not precede your faith. They should be the outflow of your faith. How often people miss this? Now, a lot of people can quote just a couple verses out of the Bible. They know verses like, oh, yes, the Bible says, judge not lest you be judged, so stop witnessing to me. Or once they start to understand your message, maybe they have a little Bible knowledge. They seem to even know James 2 better than John 3:16. And so they'll just quip and say, oh, well, you know, faith without works is dead, so you got to live a good, holy life to get to heaven. After all, Peter says that. It's in James 2. James 2 does say faith without works is dead, James 2:17. But what does it mean to have a dead faith? It doesn't mean a faith that never existed. It means you're not walking. You're on your back. You're a corpse at that moment, effectively speaking. And when one walks by faith, and that's what James 2 is about, he is delivered from the indwelling sin nature's power, from the world's influence, from Satan. You are practically sanctified as a result of a walk of faith. That's the deliverance James 2 is talking about. It's not talking about how to be initially justified in the sight of God. But notice, faith detached from works is dead. And death in the Bible never means non-existence, it means separation. So there's a detachment. Now, does God want our faith to be dead? Absolutely not. But at times it can be, can't it? You know, the book of Hebrews flips this around and talks about dead works. In Hebrews 6:1 and 9:14, it admonishes them regarding dead works. Works that don't have faith. And how does that fit the context of Hebrews here? Well, remember, they were going back to the temple. They were turning their back on, or were in danger of turning their back on Jesus, going back to the temple. And in so doing, they would not be walking by faith. So they'd go through all the religious exercises, rituals, routines. They'd think they were spiritual, fulfilling the law, and so forth. And the writer of Hebrews says, those are all dead. Dead works. Because they don't have faith. So he says in Hebrews 6:1 that repentance from dead works is a change of mind away from those old works of Judaism to Jesus Christ. And you know what? We can have dead works in our Christian life too, can't we? We can have a dead faith and we can have dead works if we're not walking by faith. So they worked righteousness, subdued kingdoms. They also obtained promises, verse 33 says. And thus Solomon can write in summary regarding his reign, or it's written about him in 1 Kings 8:56. Blessed be the Lord, he says, who has given rest to his people Israel according to all that he promised. There has not failed one word of all his good promise. Don't you love how he describes the promises of God? They're good promises. Not one word has failed, which he promised through his servant Moses, he goes on to say. Now, this does not mean that all prophecies given to Israel were fulfilled by Solomon's lifetime. As we see here, even in Hebrews 11, verses 39 and 40, there are prophecies yet to be fulfilled for Old Testament saints who are Israelites. But I think this does underscore for us an important truth regarding our Christian life, that we don't live the Christian life based on promises we make to God, for those we break, right? And those are not faithful. Rather, we are to live the Christian life based on promises he makes to us, because not one word from him can fail. And his promises are good, not the kind of lies we make to God, right? Oh, I'll do this or that for you. I promise, God. Don't ever make those kinds of promises. Like Peter, remember him? Lord, I'll never deny you. How long did it take Peter to break that one? Not even a day. And that's how we are. But in the book of Hebrews, what does it say about faith and the promises of God? Chapter 4 is all about this, the faith rest life. In order to have spiritual rest as a believer in your soul, what do you need to have? Number one, truth from God, the promises of God. But that in itself will not guarantee you spiritual rest. Your volition is involved, and you need to personally choose to accept or trust those promises of God and mix them with your faith. And if you do, you will have spiritual rest. And there are thousands upon thousands of promises in the Bible there for us to claim and utilize day by day as part of the grace resources God has given to us. Are you enriching yourself that way on a daily basis? I trust that you are. They not only subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises, but they stopped the mouths of lions, these Old Testament saints. Who were these men who did this? Well, Samson is an example of this. He ripped apart a lion with his bare hands. Now, how can you do that? Well, it just so happens in that passage, it says the Holy Spirit came upon him, and thus he was able to do it. So he had supernatural strength to do this. So Samson's an example of one who stopped the mouths of lions. David was one who did this. Remember when he was a shepherd, he went out and slew a bear and a lion. He was brave. He was selfless. He was sacrificial. He saw there was something worth more than his own life, and he was willing to trust God and take on those lions. Isn't that incredible? And he was just a kid. No wonder he was ready to take on Goliath. Our faith is so feeble by comparison, isn't it? David is a tremendous example of faith that we ought to follow. Not all of his life, but in his example of faith, for certain. Then there was a man named Benaiah who was part of David's army. He was a commander, and he also tore apart a lion, it says, with his hands, or physically speaking. And they probably called him General Lionheart. And there was Daniel. You know about Daniel, right? Daniel in the lion's den. He was put there for his faithfulness to God because he continued to pray, even though it contradicted the king's order. But you know what was different about Daniel? The mouths of the lions were stopped in his case, not because he laid his hands on them and ripped them apart and killed them, but they stayed alive all night long, looking at him. I'm sure he looked at them. Maybe he looked away at times, too, and just said, keep protecting me, Lord. It's going to be so good so far. But God quenched the hunger of those lions and stopped their mouths. Isn't that amazing? What a victory by faith that night. But again, God was behind it. And then Hebrews 11 goes on to speak of these Old Testament saints who quenched the violence of fire. What is this referring to? Well, again, the book of Daniel It refers to those three great characters, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, or Shadrach, Meshach, and away we go, right? But notice in this picture here, it accurately depicts what was written in Daniel chapter 3 about those three men in the fiery furnace. And again, they were there because they would not bow down to the golden image, to the king's edict, and thus they did not bow down like the rest of the world around them. They stood by faith, and there were consequences. Now, in their case, they did not know whether or not they would be delivered. They just said, Lord, we are willing to die, and if by your grace you want us to live, great. If not, we're ready to die. Wow, what a yielded posture. The Lord's will be done. So who is the fourth character in the fiery furnace with them? It was none other than the Son of God, Jesus Christ. You know, as a believer in Jesus Christ, while we're in Hebrews 11, just flip a chapter to your right. So we think of a great promise for us in this dispensation of grace. You know who is with you wherever you go? Metaphorically speaking, whatever fiery furnace you may find yourself in, or like I know in Dennis Coughlin's case one day, a fiery van he was delivered from, right? By faith. It's part of his testimony. We know that God is with us as believers all the time, no matter what the circumstances. It says Hebrews 13, verses 5 and 6, let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. For he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. In fact, the Greek has three emphatic statements of denial. I will never, ever, ever leave you or forsake you. So we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man can do unto me. Verse 6 is the byproduct of the promise of verse 5. The Lord is with us wherever we go. That speaks of eternal security. It also speaks of his daily comfort he provides for the believer. Hebrews 11, if we go back there, goes on to say in verse 34 that these Old Testament saints also escaped the edge of the sword. They escaped the edge of the sword. We don't have time to go into the events in which this happened, but a couple of events, I just will summarize them, are significant. Remember after Elijah had killed all the false prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel? What happens? He's looking back to past victories instead of continuing to keep his eyes on the Lord. So he runs for his life and he begins to fear Jezebel, Queen Jezebel, who sends out assassins to get him. And he runs in fear, but you know what? God is gracious. And he still protects and provides for his servant Elijah. And Elijah is saved. He escapes the edge of the sword. You can read about that in 1 Kings 19. Or another story I love is in 2 Kings chapter 6 with Elisha, who succeeded Elijah as a prophet in Israel. In that day and age, in chapter 6, the Syrian army had come upon Israel and was set to destroy them. And so Elisha did what all men and women of God should do. They turned to God, they looked up, and said, great is our need, Lord. Who is able to withstand this army? And God said, you know what? Through you, Elisha, I'm going to show you and those who are with you the invisible. I'm going to pull back the curtain for a moment so you can see the reality behind your present circumstances. And the reality was, as God let him see, that the mountains were covered with horses and chariots of fire, it said. The Lord's army. And no one could withstand the Lord's army. And thus Israel was preserved from the Syrians. Now, I don't know if there's chariots of fire all around us. But I know this. The Lord is with us all the time. And he has hosts of angels as well. And though we can't physically see what's going on behind the veil of this life, you can be sure that there's plenty going on, and you have a great protector and advocate in the Lord Jesus Christ. They escaped the edge of the sword. And as I think of that word escaped, reminds me of 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, where we are promised again, no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted or tested beyond what you are able, but with the temptation or test, could be translated either way, will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. God provides the way of escape. We're to walk by faith through our trials with the Lord and then let him open the door of escape instead of always looking for the escape hatch, instead of looking unto Jesus. But this is a great promise. And so these Old Testament saints escaped the edge of the sword. The Lord allows us to escape at time. My wife tells me, Tom, there have to be angels working overtime when I drive with you, when I ride. If you're driving, I am not kidding. So he makes a way of escape over and over again. Out of weakness, it says in Hebrews 11:34, they were made strong. Turn with me, if you would, for this one to 1 Samuel chapter 17. They were made strong. I love the story of Gideon. Remember him? Gideon blew the trumpet and they, put up the torches. And that was God's plan to overcome the Midianites. In Judges chapter 6, it says this in verses 14 through 16. We'll get to David here in a second. But let's talk about Gideon for a moment. He's a great example of being made strong out of weakness. Like Timothy, perhaps, in the New Testament, like a lot of us, Gideon was timid. He was not prone to trusting God. In fact, that's why he did the whole Operation Fleece, to test God, even though God had just revealed his will. But in Judges chapter 6, look what it says in verses 14 through 16. Then the Lord turned to him and said, go in this might of yours, and you shall save Israel from the hand of Midianites. Have I not sent you? So he said to him, oh, my Lord, how can I save Israel? Indeed, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house. And the Lord said to him, surely I will be with you. There's the key. And you shall defeat the Midianites as one man. I will be with you. Your own might is not sufficient, but my might is more than sufficient. Will you trust me, Gideon? And so in the next chapter, chapter 7, it says in verse 2, and the Lord said to Gideon, the people who are with you, who you've gathered together as an army to fight against the Midianites, that's the context, the people who are with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into your hands. Now you would think that you'd want the biggest army possible, right, to ensure the victory? God's ways are not man's ways. He turns things totally around. In fact, almost to the very issue, you can take something that the world teaches and says is right, and then just do exactly the opposite, and that's going to be the will of God. So God says, you got too many there, because you're going to be prone to trusting yourself then, and trust in the arm of flesh, which will fail you. The people are too many who are with you to give the Midianites into your hands, lest Israel claim glory for itself against me. Can believers be against God? Yes, when we don't walk by faith. And we steal glory from God. And then we would say, my own hand has saved me. And let him who glories glory in the Lord, right? Only in the Lord. Thus it goes on to say in verse 7, then the Lord said to Gideon, by the 300 men who have lapped up water in that certain way, I will save you and deliver the Midianites into your hand. Let all the other people go home, every man to his place. 300. And you know what God did with those 300? He said, here's the attack plan. I want you to encircle the Midianites, spread out, because there's only 300 of you. Keep your torches enclosed so they can't see at night that you're approaching. And then at just the right moment, I want you to break open the wrappings around the torches and make them visible and blow the trumpet. Sound like a good plan to you? Where's the swords? Where are the cannons? Where's the horses to get away? Where's the horses to go descend down upon the Midianites and attack them? Nowhere. You talk about a by faith plan. This was one. Just like Joshua at Jericho, same plan. The world would have never come up with such a plan. But that was a plan which glorified God, and God got them the victory. This illustrates for us the Zechariah 4:6 principle, that it's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord, that I will get you the victory. Or we could say the 2 Corinthians 12:9 and 10 principle. As the Lord said to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, Paul says, I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, reproaches, and needs, and persecutions, and distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Because when he is weak, and depending on the Lord, then it's God's strength that can operate through him. So these Old Testament saints, out of weakness, were made strong. But it also says in Hebrews 11 that they became valiant in battle. And that's why I had you turn to 1 Samuel chapter 17, because David is a great example of this, made valiant in battle. Remember, he was just a ruddy kid who put on Saul's armor, and he couldn't even walk around with it. It was so clunky and heavy. So he said, take it all off. I'm just going to take my slingshot, my smooth stones, and I'm going to trust God. And boy, did God use him. In 1 Samuel 17, let's read together, verses 42 through 47. It says, and when the Philistine, the giant that is, looked about and saw David, he was the man that Israel sent out to do battle with him. Are you kidding me? This punk? He had disdain for him. He disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy, and he was even good looking. What kind of warriors? You send me out a model? I want a real man to fight. This is insulting, he's thinking. So verse 43, so the Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. At least that's how it sounds on the Patch the Pirate tape. Then David said to the Philistine, you come to me with a sword, with a spear, and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, those invisible armies, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied, and in so doing, you've defied God. Verse 46, this day the Lord will deliver you into my hand. Notice David doesn't say, this day you're mine, I've got you. No, he says, the Lord is the one who will do the deliverance. Where was the object of David's trust? It was the Lord. The Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you and take your head from you. Now, this is what we would call on the football field trash talk. But it was true what he was saying. And this day I will give the carcasses of the camp of the Philistines to the birds of the air and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Then all this assembly shall know that the Lord does not save with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. You have trials in your life right now, whatever they may be, in various shapes, forms, variety. Don't take the battle upon yourself. Listen to the promises of God's word. Know the character of your God. Trust him. And let him fight your battles for you. The battle is the Lord's. Now that is a great truth that you can apply over and over and over again throughout your Christian life. David became valiant in battle because God worked in his life as he trusted the Lord and was willing to do so. What was another result? We're told in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 34, that consequently, because of David's faith and victory that God wrought, this turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Now, this isn't Will Smith and Independence Day, of course. This is Israel, and the aliens are the strangers from foreign lands that had come upon Israel, their surrounding neighbors, even the Philistine giant here. So what does it say in verse 51, reading on? Therefore David ran and stood over the Philistine, took his sword and drew it out of its sheath and killed him, and cut off his head with it. And when the Philistines, plural, saw that their champion was dead, they lost all their faith in a man, and they couldn't fight. And they fled. And here's a principle that's true for believers as well. When you lose faith in God, you begin to look at men, and you'll even run from little boys with slingshots. They turn to flight the armies of the aliens, it says. Now going on in Hebrews 11, verse 35, here's another positive triumph recorded there, if you want to go back there. Hebrews 11. It mentions women. Women who received their dead raised to life again. Now it is something when a woman who is so bound to the child she gave birth to, who she nurtured, who she poured her heart and life and soul into, who she sacrificed for, who she identified with, whose life was wrapped up with her own. And that boy dies. Her heart dies. And so we have the story of Elijah, who God used to come along with the widow of Zarephath and raise her boy from the dead, to bring him back to this physical life. And then Elisha did the same thing with the Shunammite's son. Life from the dead. Now, can you think of anything greater than the ability to have life from death? That is amazing. Only the living God can do that. What strength we see, what life, what grace we see so far in this description in Hebrews 11, that these men and women of God were able to subdue kingdoms, work righteousness, conquer in that sphere, even over nature, thinking of fire and beasts and animals and things. Amazing. It reminds me of Jeremiah 32:17, where Jeremiah says, "Ah, Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and stretched out arm. There is nothing too hard for you to do today on the street where I live and go to work in my small corner of the universe. So I'm going to trust you today and see what great and mighty things you can do." Those are the triumphs of faith, dear saints. But as we go on in Hebrews 11, it says, and we're going to go through these more quickly, of course. We've seen the positive examples in verses 32 through 35, where God's will for you as you walk by faith may involve these kinds of great victories and triumphs. Now, this should have been an encouragement to these saints in the book of Hebrews who are reading this for the first time, to go on and trust God, just like with us. But he wants to qualify, this writer does, and balance this truth, because there are many times, too, where God allows us to suffer, doesn't he? It's really tragic that you hear people say today, "Oh, you know, well, if you were really trusting God and walking by faith and seeking to please God, you wouldn't have the problems in your life that you have." Isn't that what Job's counselors told him, his friends, supposedly? Isn't that what the health and wealth prosperity preachers are saying today? That if you really have faith, things will go well in your life. But you know what? God has not promised us a bed of roses. There's often thorns, right? And what happens when we believe false promises that don't come from God, that everything's going to be great? Well, doesn't that set God up for failure and you? Because think about it. If things aren't going so rosy in your life, and God has promised you this, well, then whose fault is it? Well, that only leaves two options, right? Either God is failing me, God forbid, perish the thought, or I'm failing him in my walk of faith, and I'm really not trusting him. And that false theology is absolutely devastating to believers. Biblically, we know And furthermore, I would say this, that false theology encourages you to walk by sight, not by faith. It's easy to say, well, God is with me, God is blessing me when everything's going well. What about when it's not? Are you still in the will of God, even though you have all this opposition? It may be that you are never more so in the will of God as when you have great spiritual opposition. That's why the writer of Paul in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 7 says that we are to walk not by sight, but by faith. And even in Hebrews 11, verse 27, we saw the example of Moses. How did he endure? He endured as seeing him who is invisible. That's walking by faith and not by sight. And so we go on. In Hebrews 11, in verse 35, there is a significant shift here. After these women who received their dead back to life again, it says, others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. That word for tortured is the Greek word from which we get a timpani, something which is stretched tight and then drummed, struck like a drum. And you know what they would do in the ancient world? They would pull people tight on a rack or over a wheel to expose and stretch their abdomen. And then they would take a drum and they would pound on that person's abdomen until their insides were mush and their intestines would pour out. I don't mean to be graphic for a moment here, but you need to understand what the writer of Hebrews is about to describe. This actually happened. This is a commentary by Philip Hughes, and he says, in regards to this section here, the brutal tortures that they chose to endure, these Hebrews, in the intertestamental period of the Maccabees, the brutal tortures they chose to endure, rather than renounce the truth and defile themselves by eating swine's flesh, which, by the way, Antiochus Epiphanes had ordered them to do, this pagan ruler, and thus break the law, the Old Testament law, they refused to eat swine's flesh in order to gain their release. And so here's what their tortures included as a consequence for this. Tearing out the tongue, scalping, mutilation, and frying over the flames. And the instruments used by their interrogators in the attempt to break the spirit of these and other indomitable martyrs were, the writer tells us, wheels, joint dislocators, racks, bone crushers, catapults, cauldrons, braziers, thumb screws, iron claws, wedges, and branding irons. I don't even know what all those are, but it sounds pretty bad to me. Can you imagine having to go through that? And all because they wouldn't just eat pork, which at that time, under the law, was still what the law required. Now, would you be willing to say, give me that ham? I'm not going through that. How easy it would be to compromise. How easy it would be for us to say, you know, I don't want to offend anyone about the gospel. Why can't we just add repent from your sins to faith in Jesus? And then we could get all these people off our back. Right? Yet these people said, no compromise. God's will is worth doing 100%, or it's not worth doing at all. This is what they went through. Amazing. Saints before the cross, saints after the cross suffered things like this. Now, I'm not saying by using the Maccabean period as an example that the books of Maccabees are inspired and should be part of the canon. They're not. They're not inspired of God. But what they do represent is the history of people in the intertestamental period up to the time of Christ who did suffer greatly for God, the God of Israel, the one true God. And saints of all ages, even after the cross, have done the same. Why? That they may obtain a better resurrection, verse 35 says. What is the better resurrection? Better in terms of being restored back to life? Better than what verse 35 had just said earlier in the verse? That doesn't make any sense. Yet that's what a lot of commentators say. Better than simply being resuscitated and brought back to life. Because even the unsaved, we know from Scripture, are going to be resurrected, right? Yeah, and then they'll be resurrected and judged. So that can't be accurate. I think what is the accurate interpretation here is that this resurrection will be coupled with greater reward. And Hebrews 10:35, 11:6, 11:26, all in the context, point to this. Luke 14:14, and many other passages tie the resurrection of the just to the reward. When do you get your reward for eternity? When you're resurrected as a believer. When we're raptured, when we see Jesus Christ, the judgment seat of Christ occurs right after that. That's why Revelation 2:10, the Lord Jesus promises to that particular church that they're going to be facing persecution. He says, be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. What is the result of being faithful to the Lord up to the point of martyrdom? It is getting a reward. That's why I agree with Robert Grimacki, who said this in his commentary about this passage, that these people did not accept deliverance through recanting and submission to error. They chose to die, knowing that they would obtain rewards for their faithfulness when they were resurrected. Absolutely true. For us as New Testament church age saints, that means the judgment seat of Christ, when we will be rewarded for how we have served the Lord. So we have this promise of glory. And I will, in the interest of time, speed things up here and not talk so much about history. It's fascinating to read what happened throughout history. If you want to read a classic, there's Fox's Book of Martyrs, which tells all about what saints of the ages have suffered. In fact, during the time of the Reformation, this was a standard book on the nightstands of many saints along with their Bibles. They would read this for encouragement. And by the way, why would you read a book about people being killed for Jesus Christ? How's that encouraging? Because they were going through the same trials and afflictions. And to read that these people were willing to die for their faith, that meant they really believed it. In fact, that's one of the proofs that the writings of Paul and Peter and James and so forth, those men who died for their faith, and John was even willing to die for his faith, God never let him. All these people who saw the risen Lord Jesus were willing to say, you know what, it's true, and I'm willing to stake my life on it, and it did cost them their life. And then you had, during the period of the Inquisition, after pagan Rome, with the circus, where Christians were rounded up and eaten by lions, then you had the Inquisition period, where if you didn't recant, you were tortured, even unto death. That went on for centuries. And then there came the time of the Reformation. A man like Thomas Cranmer, many were burned at the stake. Cranmer first wouldn't stand up for Jesus Christ. He conceded, he caved, he compromised. But eventually, after 2 years of imprisonment, he said, I can't do this any longer. I have to be faithful to Jesus Christ. So with the hand that he had compromised with and signed his release previously, he said, that is the first thing I want to hold out over the flames and set on fire when they burn me at the stake. And that's exactly what he did, history tells us. Burned alive for Jesus Christ. Amazing, amazing suffering and persecution. How very different from what we see being taught today. What did these Old Testament saints go through? Trials of mocking, scourgings, chains, imprisonment, verse 36 says. They were stoned, sawn in two, probably a reference to Isaiah. We don't know for sure. That's what history tells us. History can be wrong. They were slain with a sword. And as you read the references on your handout there, you see all of this. This is what happened to them. They wandered about in sheepskins, goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented. They had no home here on the earth, in deserts and mountains, in dens and caves of the earth. Very unlike Joel Osteen, Mr. Prosperity Preacher. There's his home. Pretty nice, huh? That's what the prosperity gospel is all about. Why wait for heaven when you can get your mansion right now? But he's there building a mansion for us. But in the meantime, before we get to heaven, we're to be content with food and clothing, such things as we have, 1 Timothy 6:8 tells us. And be reminded, dear saint, where's your real citizenship? It's in heaven, right? Not here on earth. And this underscores for us several principles about your relationship to the world. As a believer, don't forget you've died with Jesus Christ to the world. This world is not your home. You've been identified with Christ. There's your real identity. Galatians 6:14 tells us this. By whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Likewise, as a believer, you're not to be conformed to this world, Romans 12:1 and 2 tells us. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, Romans 12:2. And also, as a believer, we're not to love this world, for it is opposed to God and is passing away. 1 John 2, verses 15 through 17 declare this. Do you believe what the Word of God says about this? That our world is really a Titanic going down? And our calling now is not to party on the ship. It's to call people off the sinking ship, not clean up the fishbowl or rearrange the furniture on the deck, so to speak. God uses trials in our lives as Christians. 1 Peter 1, verses 6 through 7. See, I told you I'm going to go fast through the end here. You can write these down. God uses the trials in our life to refine us and purify us as though we're tested by fire, verse 7 says. So why? So that we may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Do you know that that's actually the praise, honor, and glory he's going to give to us? Yes, we will give him praise, honor, and glory. That is absolutely true. That's our first priority. But this passage is promising something he gives to us. He will praise you and say, well done, good and faithful servant. He will honor you with a crown and give you glory, eternal glory that you can share in. And that's why the sufferings of this present time, Romans 8:18, are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall follow. Our light affliction is but for a moment, 2 Corinthians 4:16 through 18 says. But it is working for us an eternal weight of glory, those unseen things. So we come to the end of this section, verses 39 and 40, and it says, and all these people having obtained a good testimony through faith did not receive the promise. The telos of their faith was that which is complete or mature. The word telos, the noun form, here it's the verb form, teleao, translated perfect in verse 40. It can mean the end of something, like a period of time. It can mean a goal or a purpose. I think here it speaks of maturity or completion, like in Philippians 3:15. And what this is saying here, and all these having obtained a good testimony through faith did not receive the promise, God having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. It's saying that those Old Testament saints and us, we share in God's prophetic plan. There's differences, but God wants things to come together at some point in the New Jerusalem, as we'll see. As believers, even if God's prophetic promises are not fulfilled in our lifetime, like they weren't for these Old Testament saints we just read about, we can still have a lasting testimony by faith. And isn't that what Hebrews 11 is about? Remember verse 2 at the beginning of this chapter? By faith the elders obtained a good testimony, a lasting testimony, so that after they died, like Abel, they being dead yet speak. What kind of lasting legacy or testimony are you leaving behind? Your life is short. You're going to die. It's certain unless the rapture occurs and you're saved. But what are you going to leave behind that will be useful in pointing people to Jesus Christ, the only thing that really matters for all eternity? Now, verse 40 has been confusing to some. God having provided something better for us that they should not be made perfect apart from us. Is this saying that the church and Israel are one people of God? Do we share the exact same promises? No. What it's saying is that they, the Old Testament saints, had to wait for us, that is the church, because God wanted to bless both and to share in the New Jerusalem together. So God's prophetic future kingdom promise to Old Testament saints included the New Jerusalem, that city which Abraham looked for, whose builder and maker is God, which would not be complete, telos, without church-age believers. Turn with me to our last passage and we'll close here, Revelation 21. Jesus Christ said in John 14, verses 1 through 3, that he's going to prepare a place for us as believers, the Father's house. And I believe that is the New Jerusalem that he is building for church-age believers, the heavenly city, heavenly in origin, character, and so forth. And that city one day is coming. Saints have looked for it down through the ages. And one day it is going to be upon the earth in his eternal kingdom. And it's described here in Revelation 21, verses 10 through 14. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. Her light was like a most precious stone, like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. Also, she had a great and high wall with 12 gates and 12 angels at the gates, and the names that were written on them, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. And then skipping down to verse 14, it says, now the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. The 12 apostles represent the church. The 12 tribes represent Israel. Both will have access to this new Jerusalem. This is the city that saints have looked for. And I think as pilgrims and strangers passing through, it's what we ought to look for as well. Actually, look for our blessed hope first, the Lord Jesus Christ. But into the ages of eternity, this will be our eternal abode. The celestial city the pilgrim looked for. So what can we learn about all this regarding faith? That faith sees him who is invisible. Are you seeing him right now by faith that way? Faith involves your will or choice, like Moses, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God and passing pleasures of sin in this world. And faith involves mental consideration, reckoning, legizomai, the Greek word is. It's found throughout this passage. A mental calculation that considers the word of God and stands upon it by faith. And finally, faith lays hold of God's promises for the past, for the present, and the future, which ought to affect how we live now and into eternity. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word today. Much rich truth here to ponder and apply. We pray, Father, that we would just respond to your Spirit's ministry in our hearts and lives and truly trust you and walk by faith, that you would be honored and glorified as a result. We pray this in Christ's name.